Welcome back to the Shame Plays Let's Play series of Torment, Tides of Numenera. I'm playing as a Jack character. Let's see again what my... I am a clever Jack who breathes shadow. That's my type and descriptor and all that good stuff. So, Tybir, before I started recording, made a rather interesting comment about sailors that leads me to believe that he digs dudes. So, just in case you're curious about companions' personalities, he was like, ooh, look at all these sailors running around. So that you might want to know if you're curious about more information on the companions. So, okay, we are going to go to Government Square and see if we can... actually, we're trying to rescue Tybir's friend, who is currently going in a multi-day execution process. So we're going to try to go to Government Square and see if we can do something about that. Okay, here we are in Government Square. Irithor Bryn. I don't see how to get to Irithor. Little faces in the... What is that? The structure is made of a strange material that seems halfway between wood and stone. Alien symbols are drawn in red upon the stones, upon the walls. Actually, probably not supposed to be seeing this yet. But I guess in the isometric view, I can see it. So, let's wander around and talk to some people. Yeah. Merchants and wealthy townspeople. Let's talk to this wealthy townsperson. We are trying to reach an agreement on spice prices. Our Vargellan friend is being difficult. Ah, an outsider. Good. I seek clarification of a strange matter. We've been in negotiation with this mad visitant for over 3 hours. Well, it doesn't seem like I can do anything.
I'm going.
Like, I can't engage in actual conversation with anybody, so... We're trying... If I have to hear myself... If I have to hear it explain ethics one more time, I'll hurl myself off a cliff. We're trying... He's saying the same things over and over.
One moment, and it's done.
Well, I mean, what do these wealthy townspeople have to say? Climone is my dearest friend, but exhausting nearly all of the time. Well, it's about to... Oh, you're not the guide, are you? Damn. Cress and I hired a guide to take us on a hunting expedition. He's yet to show his face. If I had my heart set on hunting for dinner tonight... Oh, I had my heart set on hunting for dinner tonight. Scant chance of that now.
Like a whisper.
All right, what is this? A ladder? Can we go down the ladder? Evidently we can. Metal rungs have been fastened to the side of the structure, extending into the darkness below. I do want to climb down and see where this goes. I think it goes into the underbelly, but let's see. Yep, the underbelly. That's what I thought. Okay, so here we go.
All right.
That's what I thought. Yep, climb up. I thought I had remembered one of the foremen in the manufactory saying that led up to Government Square, but I wasn't positive. Okay.
Sure.
Wealthy, a levy. Oh, that's a cool looking. Ooh, what is this? Some cool stuff around here. Let's go talk to a city official. It's my job to inspect the levees. Gods know they won't report broken equipment on their own. Okay? Not now, dear.
Why not?
I'm a deer? Can't really talk right now. The negotiations are at a crucial point. Okay. What in the world is this?
Of course.
This fountain is constructed of a material that seems halfway between wood and stone, much like this over here was. It doesn't contain water, as might be expected. Instead, it's filled with swarming, tiny fish-like creatures that leap and cavort in a wriggling mass, chattering to each other in what sounds like a thousand different tongues. Huh. Listen to what they're saying. You fold your arms, listening intently to the fish jabber at each other. It sounds like a cloud of nonsense syllables mashed into baby speak. Oh. Anamnesis. This is the skill that lets me access my previous memories of the changing god, I guess. A few oft-repeated sounds tug at your memory until something unravels. You stand before a rusty intelligence terminal, surrounded by crooked ruins. Laying unfamiliar hands against the cracked glass, you speak words in all the languages you know. This takes some time. The terminal awakens at the sound of an ancient guttural greeting. You recognize it immediately as one of the words the fish-like creatures are babbling cheerfully at each other. Okay. Wonder if this is kind of a nod to the Babel fish from Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. Spend more time listening. Fish-like creatures continue to gibber a song of melodic symbols. Okay. Examine the woodstone fountain. The fountain, now that you're looking at it, is unfathomably old. Coppery, tongue-like decorations curl up and over the rim of the structure, as if lapping at the endless stream of creatures within. Huh. I want to try to catch one. Who's got a good chance? She's got 100% chance. What do you have? 60%? 65%? 95. Let's go with a 95% chance. Yay, success! You deftly snatch a single fish from the glistening, tumbling flood. The bubbling mass of remaining creatures squawk together in nonsensical outrage. Huh, I got a jolly. What is a jolly? You caught this creature from a fountain of sorts in Government Square. Small fish lacking, constantly squirming. It never requires food or other nourishment, and it gibbers constantly in an indecipherable language. Okay? Try to catch another one. Oh, ouch. You close your hand around another fish. Tiny teeth chomp at the flesh between your fingers, and you release it with a curse. Okay? Took one damage. Okay. So.
Why not?
Why not? Who is Sangolin? Let's go talk to Sangolin. A tall, thin, and exquisitely dressed older man stands in the shade of an exquisitely crafted, so he's exquisitely dressed, he's exquisitely dressed, and his stall is exquisitely crafted. Exquisitely crafted stall. The cut, color, and quality of his clothes are a symphony of harmonious coordination, while the expression of benevolent condescension he gives you would be more at home on the face of a king. "A good afternoon," he says, bowing slightly. "I am Sangolin, and this is my store. Sangolin's fittings. Welcome. How may I be of service?" What do you sell here?" "I sell the finest city wear for discerning men and women, as well as quality armor for those traveling to less civilized locales." He clears his throat and directs your attention to a well-dressed mannequin wearing the badge of a city official. "Also, it is our honor to have been chosen to provide the city of Sagas Cliffs with the official badges worn by all properly credentialed city employees. You may trust in their trust in us." I do need a badge. That's one of the things I need for that quest to save the guy who's being executed. Can I buy an official city badge? "City badges are not for sale to anyone. They are given to duly elected or appointed public servants of Sagas Cliffs, and it is illegal for me to give them to anyone who does not work for the city. I would be breaking the law. Of course, most public servants do offer me some rumination for the materials, but no, I would not take the risk, nor betray my trust." Tybir, but you wouldn't be breaking the law. My friend here has just been made undersecretary to Overseer Yin. A messenger should be coming shortly with the letter of commission. But you know how Yin is. Always a bit sloppy with his paperwork. Deception. That's all right, Tybir. He'll hear soon enough, Sangolin. Yin's delay won't be a problem, will it? Thank you, Tybir, but that's asking too much of this gentleman. Perhaps we could mitigate the risk to him. Thank you, Tybir, but there's no need to press the issue. Let's talk about something. I'll say perhaps we could mitigate the risk to him. He purses his lips. Single one. I'm afraid I am unbribable, my friend. But if you were to purchase this fine pair of red boots for, say, 80 shins, it is possible I may leave something of value in the left boot by accident. Let me ask you about something else. Certainly, sir. Tell me about Government Square. He puts a finger to his chin. Let me think. There's Council Tower, just over there, and the Order of Truth, and you can't forget the Red Thicket, that walled courtyard on the edge of the square. Or were you curious about our fountain here? Tell me about the fountain. One of the stranger and more poignant attractions in the square. The creatures in it are called jallies, and they chatter in a thousand dead tongues. The priests say that a new jally is born each time an old language dies. Shakes his head. You could listen to them for a month and never hear the same language twice, or understand a single one. What is the Red Thicket? The Whispering Wood, I call it. A very curious and ancient place. You can speak as loudly as you like in there, and none but your partner can hear you. A great place for diplomacy. Tell me again, or wait a minute. What can you tell me about the Order of Truth? They are a credit to our city. Wise scholars and deep thinkers. He smiles. Excellent customers as well. They are very particular about their robes. Tell me about Council Tower. It is ancient beyond reckoning. The tower's roots go all the way down to the forges in the underbelly. And within it sits the Council of Sagas Cliffs, the finest, fairest legislative body in the Ninth World. And I don't say that just because they are my most valued patrons. They have run the city well for centuries. And thanks to me, they look magnificent while doing it. Okay, I'd like to ask about something else. I'd like to see what you have to sell. So, shield. What am I wearing here? I'm wearing Avatrol Light Leather Jerkin. What is this? He's selling an Avatrol Light Leather Jerkin. That's what I'm wearing. Avatrol Leather Jerkin. Cobbled Brigandine. Two armor, one resist. I get -3 to might, -3 to speed, 15, -15% on esoteric. Why would I want that? Stout leather body armor is reinforced with small metal plates. It's heavier than a leather vest, provides more protection. Spaces are left between plates so that the armor remains flexible. Dang it! Didn't mean to do that. Can we sell it? Crud. I don't even know how much money I had, but I just wasted it on that. I did not want that. Oh, man, that was an accident. I don't even know how much money I had before that started. Dang it. I guess I could sell the jelly. I don't know if I can use it later. It's an oddity. It doesn't seem to be a quest item or anything. What is all this? Plate armor. How do I... Oh, he's selling plate armor. Okay. Grounding cloak. When damaged by energy, chemical, mental, or transdimensional damage, confers +15% on all tasks. Do I want to give him... I think I do want to give him a shield because he's using a light melee weapon. So I think I do want to give him a shield. Now he has a wait a minute. This is two-handed? Can I not... I can't use this with a
good
shield?
Good balance.
Okay. What have I got here? What can I sell to turn? I can't believe I did that. Okay, so the value is 45, so I only lost like 20 something shins. Still very annoying. What is this? Micromesh. Now that's what I'm talking about. 2 armor and 3 resistance with no negatives. That's what I'm talking about. What is he wearing? 1 armor, 2 resistance. This has 2 armor and 3. That's exactly what I'm talking about. I'm going to sell something so I can buy that. How much is it? For 65? What is this? That's worth 120. Anybody who looks at it will see their father. I'm going to sell that so I can buy this. And then this is what you're wearing. And then I'm selling this. All right, sold. Oh, he looks cool in that too. That's pretty sweet. So it says it's only usable by the last cast off. Why is that? So why none of this only usable by Callous Sage? Why is this stuff all only usable by the last cast off? I don't know. Okay, anyway, close. All right, I want to talk to this guy again. I'm going to steal a badge from him. 100% chance. I'm going to go with 90% chance. See what you're up to. Tybir distracts Sangolin by asking him about a beautiful waistcoat. While they're both turned away from you, you pluck the badge off the mannequin. Sangolin turns back to you just as you hide it. He suspects nothing.
I'll remember that.
Is that all for today? Can I interest you in a fine collection of armor, perhaps? I got this badge of office. This metal badge is meant to be worn by a Citadel official of Sagas Cliffs that is inscribed with the seal of the Protectorate. Okay. Okay, farewell. And then I got an update. Let's go to the journal. Stay of execution. Acquire an old stay of... Okay, now I've got to go to the council clerk. And get a stay of execution. Who's this? I'm going to go talk to this glaive. What's up, glaive? Again, glaives are sort of the warriors of Numenera. Just did a quick save. Mercenary. I can't shake the feeling I've been to the city before. I'm surprised people live here. It isn't exactly safe. What are you talking about? It seems alright to me. What's down here? Oh, look at all this. What goes this way? Circus Minor. Okay, I know where that's at. Order of Truth. Ladder to the Underbelly. I gotta go to Red Thicket. This is cool. I gotta go check this out. So you can only hear your partner. That's weird. It's probably incredibly rude to try to talk to somebody in here, but I'm going to go over here and talk to Irithor. This slim man looks to be in good shape, and though his face remains hidden within his hood, he carries himself with confidence. His clothing exudes something like smoke that makes him look a bit like a ghost, perhaps a man who can't be found if he doesn't want to be. Irithor Bryn, he states. Pleasure. I'm a merc. Head of the Ionthine Spectre Company. What brings you to the thicket? You see something in your expression. First timer, huh? Well, whatever we talk about here can't be overheard. Someone tries to read our lips to get gibberish. He crosses his arms. Good place to talk business, in other words. If that's what you're here for. Tell me about the Ionthine Spectre Company. We do infiltration, mostly, he says, with a smoothness that implies he's given this speech before. Sabotage, assassinations, assorted hostile recovery. Sometimes the city hires us to handle local threats. Problematic tribes, roaming predators, you name it. He chuckles, pretty quiet these days. Not like when we got started. Our first big job was a series of assaults in the Endless Battle. Keep hearing about this Endless Battle thing. What's the Endless Battle? Really? He says, cocking an eyebrow. All right, It's basically like it sounds. A fight that's given people like me a solid payday for more generations than anyone can count. He shrugs. As far as I heard, it's a scrap between rival factions of the changing gods' cast-offs. What about, I couldn't tell you. He cracks a grin. Getting interested in the why of a war always ends up being bad for business. What did you do in the endless battle? In the endless battle? Can't say, he says automatically. Contracts. You understand. All I could tell you is the Chalcedon pays on time. And that's more than I could say for some of the employers I've had over the years. He sighs. One of the best jobs we've ever had. Who's the Chalcedon? One of the commanders on the Changing Gods side, he says. Pays well and on time. And that's the extent of my opinion on the matter. Anamnesis. Try to remember how you know Irithor. Best I can do is 85%. I'll give it a 65%. Yay, got it. Success. You focus on the man, his features, and open your mind. Can we trust them? You hear yourself say, your voice muted by the years. They're mercenaries, your companion replies. Of course we can. That's not what I meant, you snap. Can we trust them to finish the work? If not, kill them now. This is no end time for uncertainty. You return to the present just in time to hear Ithor speak again. Well, are you going to tell me how we know each other or not? I have no idea. Wow, not very good at deception. She's much better. He's much better. Ithor stares you down. Something tickles the back of your mind. All right, he says, wincing. But it's not like me to forget a face, especially when it belongs to a cast-off. You lot are either hiring my people or trying to kill them most of the time. He shrugs. It'll come to me at midnight, probably, right in the middle of a good dream. And I won't forget your face again. That's a promise. Wow. What is your company doing in Sagas? Negotiations, he says shortly, and between meetings with a few council representatives. They may want us for some ongoing work. He shows his teeth. Bit of a bidding war going on right now, to be honest. We're in demand. Farewell, Irithor. That was weird. Okay. I felt like that dialogue tree jumped a little bit, because he was like, are you going to tell me how I know you or not? And I don't remember that coming up at all. Yeah, so let's go talk. It's probably rude for me to try to talk to them at all. Not now, please. Not the best time for a chat, sorry. I'm handling multiple negotiations at once. Bit distracted. I mean, these people are trying to negotiate, and I'm in here poking my nose. Oh, hello, hello. I'll be with you in a moment. Do you mind? I'm trying to have a serious conversation with my doctor. I'm afraid you've caught the two of us acting like children. You can't hear a thing I'm saying in my calling here, can you? Ooh, Ayin, who knows? Who is this? This woman's expression defies easy definition. It is cool and professional, but focused, interested. She nods at you and clasps her hands. Have you come to trade? Trade what? I'm a knowledge broker, she says, a hunter of information. Come to me with questions, and if I have answers, I will trade them. So she's like basically a paid Google. She straightens further and blinks once, managing to make the simple action look as though it was planned in advance. My pricing is simple. A secret for a secret. The only condition is that it must be one I do not already know, and I should warn you that I know a great deal. How do I know you won't claim to know a secret you never heard before? A fair question. If she is offended, she doesn't show it. But I don't bother with assurances. You can either judge my honesty yourself or take your business elsewhere. What's the catch? Well spotted, she says. Blue Tide raised a tiny amount. Well spotted, she says. There is one, of course, but it is hardly unexpected. Anything you choose to tell me will, of course, be traded to others in due time. A rare, slight smile graces her lips. In short, if you wish to keep something a secret, don't tell it to me. Why don't you trade these secrets directly to the people involved? A number of reasons, she says, but chiefly this. I am a broker. not a blackmailer. I'm interested in exchanging secrets. Good, she says simply. What information do you need? I'll say I want to propose something different. I'll trade you information for a secret you find interesting. Genuine pleasure warms her face. Agreed. What do you offer? I can tell you some secrets about myself. Would that serve? It might, she allows. What can you tell me? I was the falling star that appeared in the sky over the city. Her gaze flickers from your face to your hair, then your hands. Interesting, she says, touching the hair, the air above her wrist. But far more interesting for you, I'd imagine, especially at the time. The side of her mouth quirks. Now, for your interesting secret. She traces the corner of her lips thoughtfully. Of course. Oh, of course. My sources say that the visitant Pelai has been lining her pockets with the proceeds from Stika eggs. Okay. I want to trade information for another secret you find interesting. All right. I'll tell you a secret about my pest. I'm a cast-off. She probably already knows that. Yes, she says, you are. The tattoo was the giveaway. What else do you have? Would you accept secrets about Sagas Cliffs? Of course, she says, if I don't already know them. Of course. I'm going to say a foreman, one of the constructs in the underbelly, wants to have children. Yes, the underforeman, she says smoothly. An interesting case, but not unknown to me. What else do you have? Never mind. I don't want to trade a secret. I see. Very well. Farewell. All right. That was kind of interesting.
Absolutely,
Tybir. What else is... What is this? This goes to Circus Minor.
All right.
What else is going on around here? Levy, petitioner, council clerk. That's the guy that I need to get the stay of execution from. Nanos are sort of like the wizards of Numenera. My esteemed colleague is, with respect, an ass. Yes, you. Would you please tell my colleague? She doesn't know what she's talking about.
All right.
Not getting in the middle of that. That's kind of an interesting-looking statue there. There's a levy. Are you looking for the Order of Truth? The entrance is down the stairs. What stairs? Oh, okay, there's the Order of Truth.
Consider it done.
Let's go clear the map out. Ooh, what's all this then? Yes. There's my son getting excited. I guess he got excited that I found this.
Yes.
Towering above you is an enormous archway of metal and synth. Energy pulses through the structure, spilling from thin, transparent panels in subtle shades of gold and cyan. Examine the archway more closely. It appears to be dormant, but very much alive. The archway emits a low and constant hum. Just at the edge of your hearing, across the top, illuminated words are inscribed. The House of Empty Time. Heavy rope-like cables connect the archway to a strange generator nearby. Try to activate. Oh, I wonder if this is where the boy from the past came through. You scan the parts of the arch that are accessible from the ground, but you don't see anything that resembles a control device. Finally, you give up your search. If the arch can be activated at all, the method is unclear. Leave it alone. Can I look at the generator? Is it all
yes.
the same?
Now.
Power still flows to this ancient machine. A brassy heartbeat pulses within it, just at the edge of hearing, and tiny bubbles orbit the entire structure. No, not bubbles. Holes in space. Look through the orbiting holes in space. You lock your eyes on a hole, watching it orbit. Sometimes the building it passes in front of is still there. Sometimes they're on fire. Most of the time, however, nothing lies beyond the hole in the air but black and waste and whirling dust. Okay. Examine the device. The generator combines a huge number of mismatched parts into a functional whole. Once again, you notice the circinate symbol etched in the side like a maker's mark. I keep seeing that symbol on these old devices. Just like on the clock, you realize. Let's see. Take a closer look at the maker's mark. You run your hand over the coiled sigil. There is a panel here, but it has been bolted shut. All right, examine the device again. Generator combines a huge number of mismatched parts, etc., etc., and I see the circinate symbol etched in the side like a maker's mark. Okay. Look through the holes in space again. A sizzling boom. Whoa. A sizzling boom beam shoots out of the hole and strikes you dead in the eye. It doesn't hurt in the slightest. Instead, your mind is briefly filled with a mouth-watering image of a slab of grilled something and the chummy tones of an advertiser sales bitch in a language you don't recognize. What? Look through again. You step too close and one of the anomalies hisses past your hip like a disc made of razors. One of your pouches feels heavier. It seems the anomaly has left you a present. I got a cyclonic cube. It's an oddity. Light moves strangely through this glass cube, forming square patterns of blue and purple colors. Okay. Ooh, I have a feeling if I keep looking, I might get hurt. Look through the old holes again. For the moment, nothing lies beyond the tiny holes but utter darkness. Let's try again. Yeah. Examine the device again. Nothing. Leave the generator on. Okay.
Whatever.
Go.
Not much I can do with the archway.
Of course.
Yes. Now.
Now. That's a pretty cool looking statue.
Of course.
Of course.
On it.
What's up with these petitioners? What is taking him so long? I'm only here for a simple writ. Hey, some of us got places to be. You ain't waiting to talk to this lock spawn too, are you? Alright, let's go talk to this chump. The council clerk. Behind a lectern, a four-eyed, hairless mutant processes paper with a balletic grace. He's endlessly snapping the elegant fingers of his left hand, and each time the air twists and shimmers, either disgorging a document to be processed or accepting one that he's completed with his ink-stained right hand. Each of his eyes regards a distinct object, portals that are opening, preambles and recitals that must be reviewed, his own addenda that must be flawless. One eye twitches in your direction. Exaggerated scorn twists his mouth, and though his eye remains fixed on your face, he gives no verbal acknowledgement. The closest he comes is a faint sigh. At last, after shunting a half dozen more documents to some distant cubby, he condescends to speak. You must wait, of course, until council matters conclude. His quarter gaze leaves you. His face returns to its former equanimity, and he continues his work, which shows no evidence of slacking, let alone concluding. Let's see here. Let's see. Is there anything I can do to hurry things along? The clerk continues his masterful shuffling of papers from one portal to another, flicking a closed scroll through a gateway with a particularly deft gesture. Then he turns not one, but two eyes your way. If you are inquiring whether I would let your sweating butcher's fingers touch the council's paperwork, I fear for the state of your mind. His eyes look away and he adds, of course it is customary to render a small gratuity in thanks to civil service. One eye quickly glances back. What exactly is the customary gratuity? Without so much as a shrug of his shoulders or an inflection that would acknowledge impropriety, let alone shame, the clerk announces 60 shins. Persuasion. I assure you that matters are important enough to be worth a moment of your time. Get up to 75% with her. 75. She can get up to 100% or 80. Let's cal stage to it. And success. The clerk conveys his personal regard for the importance of your matters with a long, loud sigh. But he focuses one of his eyes on you and replies, "Very well, very well. Let us weigh the worth of your needs, shall we? What is it that you want? I'd like to talk about paperwork." A faint sigh is the only acknowledgement you receive. "I'm a special liaison from the Judicial Oversight Committee, and I need to inspect a stay of execution as issued for Cole Cardin. There are concerns of corruption." Yeah, I'm going to do deception. And I'll get to 100%. The clerk hesitates for a moment and shrugs. "It happens that the letter was consigned to destruction by year's end anyway, given the confirmation of Cardin's demise." With a snap of his fingers, the letter appears, and he looks it over. "Yes, yes, here we are. Quite the criminal he was, and no slouch in treason. But who am I to question the clemency of our peerless counsel?" He hands it to you with a slight sniff. "Let me check it for errors," Tybir snaps with an angry look at the clerk. "Of course, I shouldn't have to, but we wouldn't be here today if a mistake hadn't been made by someone in a position of authority." "Here? We're doing this here?" "Well," Tybir murmurs, slapping the document on your back, I could commit fraud in a plush armchair behind a locked door." He leans around your shoulder, flashing a grin. "But where's the fun in that?" "That's the letter of pardon. You acquired this letter of pardon from the council clerk. It grants a stay of execution for a criminal named Cole Cardin, whose principal crime appears to have been treason. Treason, treason. The paper's old and looks like it's passed through many hands, but it's certainly legitimate." You feel him writing something on the document, presumably Riss's name, before slipping it into your pouch and giving a polite little cough to catch the council clerk's attention. "Everything appears to be in order," he says, mouth set in a stern line. "I meant no offense, of course." What is this? Okay. Now I've got a forged letter of pardon. Tybir forged this letter of pardon for Riss. "Signature appears legitimate, and the language is presently official. You're no expert, but it looks like believable forgery." Okay.
I'll remember that.
The clerk turns a single angry eye Tybir's way. "Of course I understand," he says, his voice shaking. The eye moves to you. "Do we have any other matters to discuss? I'm quite busy today. I'd like to ask you some general questions." A faint sigh is the only acknowledgement we receive. "You must have uncovered some fascinating stories about the city and all this paperwork." "Naturally," the clerk replies, but for a moment, notions of privacy and probity keep him quiet. Then one of his eyes flicks your direction, and you can see he's avid to indulge the twin pleasures of the voyeur and the gossip. "There's this from an ambassador sent to the Steadfast." He snaps his fingers, summons the dispatch, clears his throat, and reads. "Today, with great ceremony, the Aeon priest buried a man said to have lived for 277 years. I asked how this graybeard had lasted so long and was told as follows. 300 years ago, there was a painting of spectacular beauty hung in the Dirkhal, a relic from before the Ninth World. For reasons unknown, the work was incomplete. The Amber Pope believed that if finished, it would reveal a truth about human nature that had eluded all intellectual inquiry. He proclaimed that whatever painter could complete it would receive a cipher that would enable him to live for 250 more years. Great artists flocked to the Dirkhal to examine the masterpiece, but when they saw it, none dared lift a brush. At last, a young whitewasher approached, carrying brushes and rollers and buckets of paint. 'I can finish this,' he declared." The Amber Pope nodded, and the boy flung an entire bucket of paint across the canvas. The blank region was filled, but the painting was splattered with white, its majesty gone. The Pope held to his vow and bestowed longevity upon the whitewasher. He was, however, borne to the torture pits below the Dirkhal, where he remained until that very day, when at last his long life ceased. The clerk folds the faded dispatch, returns it to its envelope, and sends it away, saying no more. "Who are you? Could you tell me another story you've discovered? After Chyla tore down the old ruling families, there was a time when the council stripped the euphemisms from its ledgers. And one sees such and such paid for racking a nobleman till he gave up a stash of shins, and such to settle the claims of mothers bereft of their children by rampaging mobs. He pauses. One can't debate whether this is shamelessness or transparency, but it has yielded an entry of terse brilliance, a sum allotted for the assassin to dispose of said well. He smirks. In a less literal age, said well might have been the spendthrift scion of a mercantile clan or a contessa of grand scale, but not here. These were funds requisitioned to assassinate a well. No more, no less. The eye regarding you twinkles with delight. And best of all, it seems the mission failed. One wonders, how does an assassin miss a well? All right. Who are you, and what exactly are you doing with all those papers? I am neither a tourist attraction nor a docent, he sniffs. But the irritation in his voice is only a thin disguise for the obvious pleasure he takes at your interest. He elaborates. I'm the council clerk, and unto me falls the responsibility of directing the fate of every official document in Sagas Cliffs. His tone becomes wholly boastful as he continues. I am the mind that channels the blind, nervous impulses of the city and turns it into muscular action. He preens, adding a certain flair to his routing of the paperwork. Nature, of course, provides every being with its proper niche. In here my power to bend space, my divisible vision, and my unerring integrity allow me to carry out a task no other in the ninth world could possibly undertake. He sighs, but with rapture, not exasperation. A venal man, a distractible man, an ordinary man would break beneath the temptation and strain. But not I. With that, his bureaucratic scowl returns. Anamnesis. Suddenly, the world changes. You're in a laboratory that reeks of spoiled milk. In a vat before you, floating in a gray, viscous fluid, is a very young child. His skull is in your hands, and you're kneading and stretching it like dough. Two nubbin eye spots stare from above his natural eyes. He's howling as he clenches and unclenches his tiny fist. Odd mitts appear and disappear. A blue rag, a gourd rattle, a lock of black hair. Someone else's thought comes into your head. He will do. Nature didn't create you. I created you. Yeah, I'm going to say that. Your words are enough to stop the clerk in his work, if only for a moment. All four eyes stare at you, probing, searching for a smirk on your lips or a twinkle of an eye. Finding nothing, he resumes browsing the city's papers, but some of the grace is gone from his long fingers. At last he sniffs. Next, no doubt, you'll jest about betting my mother. His forced tone reveals he took it for no joke, but for all his gifts and filing, he seems unable to fit what you've told him into his mind. All right, let's go back to the general. Silver tide went up. I don't know what silver represents. What exactly is the council, and how does it govern Sagas Cliffs? The clerk sniffs. Paper governs Sagas Cliffs. Paper allows the few to rule over the many. Paper allows the many to organize into a single whole. Authority resides in diktats, compacts, agenda, the means by which thoughts are refined, disseminated, and preserved. In a calmer voice, he adds, of course, the council has a part as well. Each of the great slave families sends a representative, and they dicker and bicker until they form the will embodied in paper. And I am their clerk. Can you tell me about the city's history? Why exactly would an overburdened clerk be able or willing to recite the city's sad tale of decline? Then a certain twinkle appears in all four of his eyes, and he begins to speak. Here's what the documents themselves reveal, not in their words, but in their very selves. He works faster as he tells the story. Centuries ago, when the Ninth World was fresh, the city began. Its founders kept meticulous records, all lost. Only the columbarium that held them remains. A time of aristocrats follows. Each paterfamilias traced his lineage to ancient heroes and inscribed these lies in stone. Today those tablets pave the midden heaps built in the wake of Chyla's rebellion. He clucks his tongue into taste. That came later. First came the Tabat, and as they laid siege to Sagas Cliffs, the city's records degraded. Like hygiene and decency, proper documentation falters in long years of terror. With a shrug and no detail, he adds. But the siege failed and the Tabat vanished. Next, an age of decadence. The long gestating consequences of the aristocracy's ever more outlandish choices. In screeds, they laid out their reasons to the people. Not to explain, but to mock. He smirks. Naturally, rebellion followed. Chyla cast down the old lords and raised up new slave families. An empire expanded, contracted. Holidays and boulevards changed names. All else persisted. Corruption, most of all. At last, a new clerk came, bringing order. He bows. And here we are. He's got a high opinion of himself. Okay, I'd like to talk about paperwork. I don't need anything else. Faint sigh is the only acknowledgement. Okay, farewell. I'm done with him. Clerk gives no acknowledgement that he heard and merely continues with his work. Continue. All right. I tried being nice. I tried signing his little papers and paying his bribes. That was hours ago. Okay, I want to go see if we can save his friend in the execution, and then we'll come back up to the Order of Truth. I don't know if we can go in here. The smooth metal door has no apparent handle or hinge. Entry must be controlled from inside. Let me go talk to Sigyn real quick. He probably controls access to the council. Sigyn, or she, not he. This woman is dressed much like the levies who flank her, but unlike them, her expression is sober and alert. Her hair is cut short, the corner of her eyes wrinkled with crow's feet. A little swarm of mechanical drones circles around her. There they are right there. Buzzing messages in her ears, she whispers replies in return, and every so often, one of them whisks away, disappearing into the city. What is it, citizen? She pauses, eyes darting to your tattoo, then to your face. No, you're the one they call Adon. I heard you were in the city. Oh, interesting. You sense a sudden wariness in her. It's been 10 years since your last visit. I was too young to know you then, but the drones remember. What do the drones remember about me? My silver went up a little bit. On cue, two of her attendant drones dip close to her ear, emitting a stream of raspy noise that might be some sort of language. You kept to your own affairs, but everywhere you went, the city held its breath. People deferred to you, even the ones with power and influence. You look the same as you do now, exactly the same. I want to know why. And if you don't mind telling me, I want to know what you're doing in Sagas now. And if you don't mind telling me, I want to know what you're doing in Sagas now. Just seeing the sights. Red Tide raised a tiny amount. Falling star, for example, did you arrive too late to see it? Or did you land on our shores at precisely the same moment? Her tone is casual, but she watches you intently. Red Tide. Huh. Another drone swoops past you, stopping just short of the woman's head, and unleashes a series of raspy buzzes and squawks. She whispers to it, then glances back in your direction. What is it you wanted? What's in the building behind you? She frowns. How is it that you don't recognize the seat of government? I know you lived here for a time. I asked a question. I expect one in return. Silver. That's why I asked, but you've given me all the answer I need. Silver Tide raised a tiny amount. She waves her hands to the doors behind her. The council meets in there. A representative from every slave family and from some of the guilds, depending upon who's in favor. Hardly anyone goes in through the doors, though. They're just a formality. Most people have other ways of getting inside and out. I've never seen a building like this one before. What is it? They say it's a ship, built by the ancients to sail the void between worlds. Now the crag grips it tight, like an old husband holds his wife, and it'll never sail free again. Huh. What were you saying to those drones? They carry my orders to levies all over the city. And they bring reports from levies back to me. She reaches out a hand and one of the drones buzzes something unintelligible. A few years ago, the Aeon priests found them buried underground and brought them back to life. I learned their language, so our conversations are safe from prying ears. Hmm. And who are you? Sigyn, captain of levies. I'm not a levy myself, but I command them. What are levies? I already know what levies are, but I want to know what she says. Soldiers in the council. Well, she gestures the two burly, smiling men to her left and right. They look like identical twins. Soldiers in the council service. They keep order in the city. Her lips purse briefly, but she continues. Every citizen is required to raise a levy for the city's defense. The price is a year of their lives. Do your levies keep every district safe? No, she frowns. Underbelly lives under its own law. Cliff's Edge lives under no laws at all. If the levies don't keep order in Underbelly, then who does? A man called Folsom. Her expression is unreadable. I don't know anything about him. We've already had dealings with Folsom. Why don't you send any levies to Cliff's Edge? A lot of homes have been collapsing, and the city hasn't been able to help. Her tone is cautiously neutral. The council believes that the presence of levies could incite them to violence. Huh. How are levies, quote-unquote, raised? Anyone who lives in the city can become a citizen at 16 years of age, or the equivalent if they're not human. There's only one requirement. They step into a machine at the Order of Truth, and it takes away a year of the citizen's life. It uses that year to create a levy. She lowers her voice, seemingly for the benefit of the levy standing beside her. That 1 year is all a levy gets. When it's over, they die. The levies seem awfully happy. A smile and a pleasant demeanor could have 100 explanations. Yet this whole city is fooled by them. She shakes her head. I know the levies better than anyone, so the truth is plain to me. Though I'd be lying if I claimed to truly understand them. Are you sure the levies aren't happy? They only seem so. Her face is flat, unreadable. They're not. I have other questions. The clerk asked me for a bribe. Is that legal? She purses her lips and stares straight ahead. It isn't illegal. Such things are customary amongst the bureaucratic class. They call it a gratuity. All right. Farewell. Farewell to you, whoever you really are.
All right.
Whatever, lady. I don't know you nothing. I don't know you nothing. Let's go see if we can rescue this guy. Yeah, it's constantly nighttime here now because I messed up the clock. Sorry, guys.
Without doubt.
Supposedly, there's a place here where I can stay. The size of the human figure that's repeated throughout the camp is highly unusual. Its use as a symbol suggests the elevation of humanity or perhaps a specific person. I thought there was supposed to be a way to... I think it was the changing... I was told that the changing god... camp would let me
you want it done right.
Stay here for I think 20 shins or something. I think I can stay here. I don't know. Let's see. Mimian. Oh, I would like to sleep here. Yeah. Okay. Do you have any supplies you could share with me? Share? Oh dear. We're a small group and not wealthy. We exist on donations, curios, and the occasional great gift from one of your siblings. For instance, we had a weapon once used by the Chalcedon. The Chalcedon? The commander of... She catches herself. My point is that we require some payment for our wares. What do you got? Intellect would be good. What is this? Cortical shunt. Plus one training level in deception. Plus 2 damage on esoteric. Negative effects. -3 resistance. Huh. Spray flesh. Let's see if I can sell him something. I will sell you this. And I want one of these. I'll just buy one of these for 40. Okay. I've got 3 of these. I've got one of these already. And I'll buy this spray flesh for one. Buy. Okay. What is this? Globe of Zrul. The synth globe clearly depicts an unknown world. The more you look at it, the more details you discover, as if the globe somehow enhances and concentrates your vision as you examine it. It's worth 89. I sold it. I'm just gonna leave it sold. That's fine. Got ciphers. I'm not gonna sell my ciphers. Okay, close. And then if I wanna sleep here, I'd like to sleep here. We'd be honored if you choose to stay with us. We do request a small donation of 40 shins to offset our cost. We must rely on donations, even from our revered visitors. Never mind. Farewell. Okay, so if I sleep at the other inn, in the other part of the city, it's 20 per person, so that's 80. So it costs half as much here. And I think it's chins or churn. There's a viewer who's left some really helpful stuff and comments on the video series. It sounds like they're getting a cheaper rate. So maybe because they're doing better at the game or have done stuff differently at the game. You know, they're getting a better rate. Maybe they solved the clock thing better than I did, because I kind of solved it, but also kind of broke things. And now it's like constantly nighttime in here. Okay. I'm going to try to see if I can rescue this risk guy. The official is staring at the dark sky as you approach. Tabot, take us all, he mutters. Yeah, he's not happy because I made the sky dark. Eventually, he lowers his eye to you and gives you an annoyed look. What is it now? Why are you staring at the sky? He lowers his eyes to you. Did you not notice? Day became night in an instant. What does it mean? Are we safe? Is it the Tabot returned again? What am I, as an official of the city, obliged to do? Nothing, dude. You just need to chill out. This man has a full pardon, or release him immediately. He scowls at you. Weren't you here before without a badge? Is this some kind of... He cuts off and looks at the black sky again. Oh, what does it matter? If you take him, I can go home to my wife. She must be in such a state over this darkness. One moment. He turns and calls the levies. Unmake the death of the condemned and set him free. He is pardoned. So that's interesting. When things went dark, because I solved the quest with the clock by breaking things, there's different outcomes you can have. So it sounds like maybe I could have come back and freed Riths without needing a pardon and a badge of authority. I don't know. Unmake the death of the condemned and set him free as pardon. What are they doing to that poor man? Well, they're not doing anything to him now. We just saved him. Ian the Overseer turns back to you. There. Now I'm going home.
Making a note.
Got 40 XP from that. Quest updated. Stay of execution. As the levies march off and the crowd disperses, Riss steadies himself, not quite recovered from his ordeal. Finally, he raises his head and focuses on you. If you're the one who got me out of that nightmare, thank you. But where's that... His eyes sidle on Tybir. There you are, you slipper. Now, where's the money? If I went through that hell for nothing, I'll... He chokes with emotion. 2 days, Tybir. I spilled my guts up there for 2 whole days. There's hardly anything left of me. Tybir steps back, spreading his hands. Yes, about the money. You see, Riss, I was hoping to get a reward for turning in the fellow who sold us the brandy without telling us about its secrets, But, Riss snarls, there's always a but when it comes to money, isn't there? I should have known. You only said you'd pay me so I wouldn't squeal on you. And you only saved my skin to save your own. He smacks his fists together. Now, am I going to have to fight through your friend to get to you? Or are you going to step out from behind him and take it like a man? Calm down, both of you. Riss, tell her from the beginning. I got indigo. A moderate amount, and blue amount, a tiny amount. Riss spits, then wipes his lips. There isn't much to tell. Captain Silvertongue here talked me into a dirty job, then disappeared like an abacus and left me holding the bag when it all went sour. Oh, Riss, says Tybir, can you blame me for running when I had the chance? You have done the same. And besides, if I hadn't, we would have both been sentenced to die with no one to free either of us. Riss... He stabs a finger in Tybir's face. You only wanted to free me because you knew you'd be next on the block once the Devourer ate me. How would the Devourer of Wrongs know that Tybir was involved? The Dinger O'Hur, says Riss, consume our memories with our flesh. They know everything by the time they finished eating us, and Tybir knew I'd have plenty of memories of him, didn't you, you coward? The Devourer would have found you guilty, Tybir? Is this true? As far as it goes, he would have learned about me if he had eaten Riss, and I did manage to escape the levies when they showed up looking for us. But I didn't abandon you, lad. He puts his hand to his heart. Riss, I escaped the levies and saved you from the Devourer of Wrongs because I love you and did not want to see you die. You have to believe me. Do I? Riss says, crackling his knuckles. Okay, what was the job? Tybir said we were transporting black market booze to Mirage Julio's, but he didn't tell me that he'd hidden state secrets in one of the bottles using some liquid Numenera trick, which turned her slap on the wrist crime into a damnable death sentence. Death sentence, Tybir says, with an uneasy grin. You're alive, aren't you? He glares at Tybir from under lowered brows. That's as may be, but you certainly seem to know when the levies were going to come calling. He looks at you. The council somehow got wind of the deal and came after us. Funny how I was the only one home when they knocked on the door. Who are the Dendro? I already know who they are. They're the people that eat the bodies. Cultists who eat human flesh to gain the wisdom of the dead. Riss shivers. The city's been using them as post-mortem judges for years. I'm with Riss on this, Tybir. You should make amends to him. He's the one who suffered here. So what do you intend to do about this, Riss? Is this going to be a fight? Yeah, I'm with Riss on this, Tybir. You should make amends to him. He's the one who has suffered. Indigo raised a small amount. Gold Tide raised a tiny amount. So gold seems to be compassion, or fairness, empathy. That's right, Riss snarls, and you can start by giving me my share of the spoils. Riss, you don't know what you're talking about. I never got paid, I promise you. This isn't over, you self-serving. Riss jabs a finger in Tybir's face. Hide behind your friend if you like, but he won't keep you safe forever. Well, I guess that's that. You're dead, Tybir. Do you hear me? Dead. Wow, we saved him. I would call it even and let bygones be bygones. Can I talk to Tybir?
Thanks for helping me free Riss, lad. Not that the little ingrate appreciated it.
So was it like Riss said, you only freed him so you wouldn't be implicated? I'd be a liar if I said that wasn't part of it, he says, looking at his boots. But I really do care for the boy, and wouldn't wish him harm for all the world. And I could have run, he chews his lips. I could have. Do you think he will make good on his threats, should we be watching our backs? I wouldn't worry about it, he says, chuckling. Riss doesn't have as many friends as he thinks he does. I was practically the only one. Let me ask you something else. What are your strengths? I want people. What do you want from me? How are you holding up? Nothing now. Let us continue on. Okay. Absolutely no problem. Okay. So we get all that done. I wonder if other people are freaking out because of the darkness. Let's go talk to one of the... Let's go talk to the seer. They're probably like, oh, it's darkness. It's the doom. You gonna put some shins in the bucket or just stand there gawking? I guess I'm just going to stand there gawking. Twin creatures of a type you've never seen flank a central orb. Their cultural significance lost on you. Yeah, I didn't even look at that before. Pretty cool. Let's see what the arms merchant has to say since it's all dark. The merchant is peeking out from under his awning at the dark sky. He shakes his head as you approach. Strangest thing I've ever seen. Ah, well. Can a little darkness stop the wheel of commerce, can't we? Welcome back. How can I help you? It doesn't trouble you that night fell so quickly? That's for the nanos to worry about. Me, I don't ask questions. Curious people get themselves killed. Show me what you have for sale. Let's see. Okay, so he doesn't have all that great of weapons. Yeah. Let's just go ahead and get out of here. Okay.
In an instant.
I'm going to go back up. And then we will get to the Order of Truth and save at the Order of Truth. Gold tied is charity, sacrifice, and empathy. It's tied to people whose primary goal is to help others, especially to cost themselves. That's what I was thinking. It was kind of charity and empathy, compassion. Okay.
With alacrity.
So the... The Order of Truth is up here. At the beginning of the game, it was like, basically, go to the Order of Truth or the Cult of the Changing God. I wanted to go to the Order of Truth, but I ended up with Callous Stage, and she was like, let's go to the Cult of the Changing God. It looks like you visit both of them either way. So, am I missing anything here? I don't think so. Underbelly, Order of Truth, Council Tower, Red Thicket, Sangolin, Circus Miner, where I just went, Caravanserai. Okay. We need to talk to the Order of Truth, and then we need to get back down to the Underbelly because there's more stuff going on with the murders down there we're investigating. And there's the one guy who's talking about the doll, whatever the Eaters of the Dead are. I'm pretty sure that one of those guys is committing the murders because he had like this bloody club at his hip, and he also had a kind of a weird attitude compared to the rest of me. He was somewhat of a new member. So thanks so much for watching the Shane Plays Let's Play series of Torment, Tides of Numenera. Oh, wait a minute. Let's level up Callous Stage. She can level up here.
Yes, child?
Yes. She's going up a tier. Select one of the following options. Okay, so extra effort is the only thing she can do. Increasing your max effort level will allow you to spend more effort when performing tasks. So I guess we'll go to 2 to 3. Yes.
Our knowledge grows, sisters.
And then I've reached tier 2. And because of that, we got dimensional power while phased, gain +2 damage, and esoteric knowledge. All other party members gain +5% on lore machinery, lore mystical, and 5% on lore natural. Nice. I guess we get both of them next. Ooh, I choose an ability because I made it to tier 2. Wow. Tropic Field on hit confers vulnerable. Okay, so it just kind of makes them more vulnerable to being hit. Flash deals 8 physical damage to all enemies struck inside the radius. Even on a miss, deals 1 damage for each level of effort applied. Wow, nice. Wow. Data Sphere Link. Gain +1 training level in lore, machinery, +1 mystical. I'm going with Flash. Oh, I can learn too. I'll take these two. Heck yeah. Sweet. Okay. Now, now that that's done with, thanks so much for watching the Shane Plays Let's Play series of Torment, Tides of Numenera. We'll catch you next time. Very much enjoying this game. I think it's fantastic. Really rich storytelling and a lot of different options and just cool stuff going on. I love the world of Numenera, the setting of Numenera. Anyway, if you would, leave me a comment and a thumbs up on the video on YouTube. That helps me out a lot. And if you haven't already, please consider subscribing to the YouTube channel. We will catch you next time on Shane Plays.